Having looked at some of your posts, I can see why people call you a white supremacist. You seem to post on a nearly daily basis racial politics and don't hold back on stating your opinions about race. That being said, are you a white supremacist?
Now maybe did I mean to treat you bad? Yeah, but I did it anyway. And then maybe some would say your life was saved. Yeah, but you lived it anyway. And so maybe your friends that stand around you watch you crumble as you fall down to the ground. And then someday friends to stand beside as you were flying. Oh, you were flying all so high. But then someday people look at you. They're what they call their own. They watch you suffer. Yeah, hear you calling home. And then someday we can take our time to brush the leaves aside.
So, I'd like to put together this project, and I don't know how much of it's going to be scripted versus how much of it is going to be like question and answer interview, but white people's self-esteem is at an all-time low. And that's kind of what this documentary I have in my head is about, is it's, maybe it's just called White Self-Esteem, and that's a call to action just in the title itself, that white people should have a self-esteem about their own race. The same way black people have a healthy self-esteem about their race. They're protective of it. They fight for their history and their culture and their unique selves, including their nations. And so white people have every right to do the same. It's completely moral, okay. There's no controversy over this. There shouldn't be. If someone tries to create controversy over it, then that tells you a lot about what their motives are, that they are openly anti-white. Because if you challenge them with any other ethnicity in their own respective nations and whether or not they deserve to be able to maintain those, the Jew majority in Israel, the black majorities in the African countries, the Indian majority in India, the obviously Asian 97% Japanese in Japan and 90-something in China, I think. It's fine for the rest of the world. Homogeneity is fine for the rest of the world except majority white European countries. Those are the only countries where it's just immoral to even conceive of trying to maintain a majority of the people who have created and sustained that nation for its entire lifetime. That's just not okay. That's just terrible. Only xenophobic, racist, anti-Semitic, Islamophobia, you know, everything. Just only the worst of the worst scum Nazis would ever want their own nations to be able to continue to exist as their settlers founded them, fought and died and sacrificed for. That's just bigotry to be able to want to keep that. It's a dangerous level of patriotism there, wanting your country to stay what it has historically been. Anywho. That's gonna do it. I'm going to bed. One of the objectives that I have for this documentary is to hopefully humanize the people who have been demonized in terms of the mainstream media's portrayal of them and what you hear on NPR about them and what you read and The Washington Post about them and what the Biden administration tell you about them. These domestic terrorists, white supremacists, neo-Nazis, people who say that they are proud of being white, that they like white culture, that theoretically there shouldn't even be anything wrong with saying that because there's plenty of black people who love black culture, plenty of Asian people who love Asian culture. You know, I hate having to list the list of examples of where it's completely normal and fine to have a healthy self-esteem about one's own race. It's just not okay for white people to do it. But what I want to show you guys is a little bit of the behind the scenes life of one of those crazy neo-Nazi domestic terrorists. What the most urgent problem in all of America is, according to Joe Biden and according to the DHS and the FBI and all that. Us people, I'm allowing you guys to put a name and a face on these scary people who are somewhere out there in the United States who are just the thing you should be scared of when you go to bed at night. So what does the behind the scenes look like of a neo-Nazi, domestic terrorist, white supremacist? Turns out it looks nothing like the propaganda film American History X, where just because you like white people, as a white person, you want to keep white people around, you want to marry a white person, you want to have white kids, just because you say those things and those are important things to you doesn't actually mean you're a hate group who runs around committing racially motivated crimes. That's what Joe Biden wants you to believe, and that's what the fear mongers want you to believe about people who are white, who have a self-awareness of white culture, and who love their fellow white people. These are the same relationships other people have with their races. It's okay for white people to have that relationship with their race as well. I know you guys haven't heard that in a long time. So now I'm talking to all you other white folk who maybe haven't put it together yet, who are trying to figure out how to reconcile what your university professor told you and what your parents told you and what the newspapers and the mainstream media have told you your entire life, which is that maybe there's not even such a thing as the white race. There is no white race. And even if there is, you shouldn't be proud of it for any reason. What, you didn't do anything special to earn it. You were just born that way. Why would you be proud of something you were just born with? That's like being proud of having brown hair. Well, guess what? It turns out races are a lot more than phenotypes. Races have cultures. Races have behaviors that are manifestations of their genes.
That's why you might actually want to take a look at your own race and decide whether or not there are things that are good or bad that fit in with the rest of society. And every race should be doing that. How much violence people tolerate, how much lewdness people tolerate, sanitation expectations, all of these things are different, culturally different, racially. So, you know, I'm back at it. I'm already back to thinking about it, but that's because I'm trying to share my mind as transparently as possible in my daily thought processes. And so when it comes to my daily life behind the scenes, you're looking at it. It's average American life. I'm about to take myself to the gym. I'm gonna do some weightlifting. It's a priority of mine. It has been for the last 10 years, prioritizing my physical health, making sure, as the Greeks and Romans already knew, a healthy body is a healthy mind. I know we live in Vimerica 2023 that says you can be healthy at any weight and all that other nonsense, but in my lived experience, I think being physically healthy is actually highly advantageous to every facet of your life. It's normal. Now, maybe you guys could consider it abnormal to sit around reading the Bible. I know that's a weird thing to do these days, but I do prioritize that as well. I try to do about an hour of reading a day, and if it's not the Bible, it's something else, usually Christian literature related or some kind of world history. But this is the average life that I wish everybody was leading. And you know, I don't want to be egotistical and say that I am the model of exactly what everybody should do and how they should live their lives. But I think there are some basic fundamental truths that no one would or should disagree with, such as it's advantageous for you to stay in good physical health. It's advantageous for you to have a relationship with your Creator, both in a divine sense, being God, who is Jesus Christ, but also in your parental sense, in your human realm, your family, your parents, to continue having a relationship with them even into your adulthood, and to be friends with them and to love them. I think that all those things are highly important, but it dramatically changes your mental fortitude and your discipline and a million other things about your life that I won't get into here. This is all to say that it's part of my daily routine to make sure I stick to the right nutrition and emphasize my physical exercise. And so I hit the gym 4 or 5 times a week. Today is going to be one of those days. I'm going to go have myself a shoulder day. But to do that, I got to get my pre-workout mixed up and give my little man, Gilbert, a treat on the way out. All right, we are on our way out of the door to head to the gym, get our happy hour in. And this is one of my favorite moments of every single day, is giving my little man his snack on the way out, because he gets so excited and he runs and he takes it to the other room. And it's one of his favorite parts of every day, so therefore it's my favorite part of every day. There you go, little man. Okay, we're gonna get some footage today going back to my old childhood stomping grounds to provide some context as to who this guy is and how exactly did he grow up and how privileged he was to have the right color skin and all that kind of stuff. So we're gonna go down all the way to, I think this is considered North Huntsville these days, and I'm gonna show you guys my childhood home and some of the old neighborhood, and you'll get to see just how privileged and entitled I was. Instead of taking the test, I took 2 to the chest. Call me blind, but I didn't see it coming. Everybody was running, but I couldn't hear nothing except gun blast. It happened so fast, I didn't really know this kid, though I survived in class. Maybe this kid was reaching out for love, or maybe for a moment he forgot who he was, or maybe this kid just wanted to be hugged. Whatever it was, I know it's because we are. Much better. Johnny boy always played the fool. He broke all the rules, so you would think he was.
brought his life to an end. They might remember him then. You cross the line and there's no turning back. Told the world how he felt with the sound of a gat.
Before I even go into the gym, you guys know I like to have my 1 hour happy hour in the car, getting caffeinated and studying. And so today I'm reading the book by Benedict Beckold called Western Self-Contempt, Oikophobia in the Decline. And I gotta tell you guys, it's painful. Like, the rise and fall of nations or empires is very, very formulaic. It's very, very predictable. And so if you just study history, you see the same patterns reemerging where an empire becomes spoiled with its lack of foreign threats because it's already conquered them all. And it becomes spoiled with its surplus of resources. And it becomes spoiled with its sense of freedom and individual rights that it starts picking away at every single imperfection in society. Every single perceived inequality becomes escalated to a national concern. And that's a lot of what this book is about. Oikophobia, if you've never heard that word, is the opposite of xenophobia. So where xenophobia says, I have a distrust or perhaps even a dislike for other people, xenophobic. Oikophobia means you have a distrust or disliking for your own people, your own nation, which is what we see from progressives, liberalists, whatever they're calling themselves these days, the Democrat Party, the people who pick America apart for all of its historic injustices and inequities and all this other stuff. People get very confused as to why this happens. Like, America is such a prosperous country. It's the most free and liberal country in the world. Yet you have these people saying that we're not free enough. We're not liberal enough. More people need to be given more rights and to do more things. And so I just came across this quote. I'll read it to you guys. This is like page 50 of the book. As the society develops, more and more rights are granted to groups as a means of holding on to the consensually voting citizens' support. This increase in equality and rights actually contributes to even more dissent, because various interest groups begin to smell blood and try to obtain even more from their government, a pattern that shall recur time and again. This is why, in any civilization, the more laws appear whose purpose is therapeutic and designed for only a particular group of citizens, the surer will be the decline of that civilization. Reparations, these protective acts for certain minority groups, etc. A law written for a particular group is usually intended to create more equality or inclusion, but in fact, it often increases social fragmentation. Plato complains that in Athens, everyone has to be made to have the same rights as everyone else and to feel equal to everyone else, children to parents, students to teachers, foreigners to citizens, and even animals to humans. With such a pathological sense of equality and liberty, any sense of authority will disappear along with all loyalty to the civilization at large. Does that sound like what we're living in? Does that sound kind of familiar? Like maybe this is just human behavior? And if you read about the things that have already happened, you can understand what's happened currently and predict where this is going in the future. Does anybody want to tell me where the Greek Empire is now? Okay. So it's sad living in the predictable fall of an empire, the decline stage of it. It's kind of a bummer. You know, you want to be born in like the rise and the conquering phase. And we're born in the decline. That doesn't mean we can't have a renaissance, which is really what we have to hope for. Like, that's what we're fighting for, is a renaissance. We're going to restructure America, reorganize however we have to, based on racial and religious preferences. And that's just kind of like the inevitable what has to happen. There's no way around this. And denying that these things need to happen isn't constructive for anybody. Pretending that race isn't real and that we can all live amongst each other with no conflict, that's not going to happen. Pretending that there's no meaningful difference between the different religions in terms of people how they want to go out and live their lives. These things, you can't have half a dozen or more different frameworks all playing out at the same time in society with racial culture and with religious culture, and then to go after attacking gender and try to pretend that there's more than two gender groups. Then you have the sexual preference groups of the LGBT, two-spirit, all the other crap. And that's what you see. It's these specialized groups where now we have to create more and more laws to attend to these specialized groups, and society just gets more and more atomized to the point where nobody sees themselves as belonging to the larger community anymore. Everybody only belongs to their little tribe. And in my opinion, there's no fixing this. There's no putting the genie back in the bottle. Like, you have to call for a family meeting and say, changes are coming and we're going to reorganize things quite significantly, and things will not be the same going forward. We're going to go forward with something new. We can't iterate on this back to a point of homogeneity and Christian lifestyle. There's no way to take what we have now and kind of tweak it to go back to that. Even though that's what we had all the way up until 1960, for 350 years, there is no way to just kind of diagnose the bugs that are in our current programming and fix it so that America is once again Christian majority and once again white majority. The way you have to address these things is openly, through government, and with force. Not violent force, not saying anybody gets violently hurt, but people actually get proactively kicked out of the country. Non-white people get kicked out of the country. Or wherever the new country's borders are drawn, white people only live there, people of European descent. And likewise, the same has to happen for religion. And they really need to intersect. It needs to be a land for white Christians. Maybe it's not all 50 states anymore. You know, who knows how the boundaries get redrawn, but we obviously don't want any of this to come through any violent military action, but it does. This is just inevitable. It has to happen. There's no other way. Because this is just the nature of human beings going back thousands and thousands of years. You go read the receipts. It's not that complicated. It does take some time, but there's another guy, I want to say Ray Dalio's The Rise and Fall of Nations. I remember watching that, and it goes through the same thing, where a sense of malaise and lethargy and, frankly, sloth and gluttony and all these things of excess that any first world country gets to accumulate after fixing all of its foreign threats so that they're not threats anymore, and optimizing all of its domestic production, well, suddenly people are sitting on stacks of millions of dollars and bushels of grapes and cheesecake and blah, blah, blah. And now the problems that used to exist get replaced with grievances over things that happened to my ancestors 300 years ago. So that's the situation this morning. I'm trying to get a little bit smarter. I'm just trying to do my reading. But the book is by Benedict Beckold. It's called Western Self-Contempt, Oikophobia in the Decline. It's very, very good. It looks like I'm about 20% through it. I'm like 20% through five different books right now. It's tough because there's just so much I'm trying to absorb. I'm trying to absorb the ethnic situation, and I'm trying to absorb the spiritual, theological situation, and trying to make sure both of them are accounted for in this documentary. Not easy stuff, but somebody's got to do these things. Somebody has to put their face on it, and somebody has to do the research so that they can be articulate to make these points cogent and digestible for the masses. We got to get to a point of talking in truth about religion, because religion is the backstop for morality where government fails. Where government can, and not just when they fail, but where government can't always be. Government can't always be in your living room making sure that your teenager isn't sneaking home some other teenager and doing things they shouldn't be doing with them while you're not in the house, right? That comes down to a morality thing. That comes down to what values did you instill in your children? Did they grow up reading the Bible, and did they grow up reading about monogamy and marriage and chastity? Or did they grow up watching MTV and dating shows and being on Tinder as soon as they turn old enough, etc.? So anyway, I'm going to get back to reading here, you guys. Downloading information, just downloading information from the cloud of human history. We talk about this digital cloud of how everything is out there. You can pull up YouTube videos and not Wikipedia. Please don't use Wikipedia, but you know, other places of information. But there is also a knowledge cloud that is not the internet. It's a book. It's like a library. You go there, and people used to spend weeks, if not years, if not, you know, decades writing books and going to the deep, deep archives of human history to figure out when this has happened before, previous empires. People used to put forth a lot of effort into formulating their opinions. And now it's just, I watch CNN for 5 minutes before bedtime, so I know what's going on in the world. Sure you do. I have a very, very big video I need to make as part of the documentary that I'm trying to figure out how to produce. And it's going to be the main question and answer session, like the main interview with me answering the difficult questions about race and IQ and etc. Trying to figure out how to discuss those topics in a productive fashion. And I'm trying to decide if I want to do that scripted or if I want to do it off the cuff. I don't know. But anyway, stay tuned. It's going to be a while. It's a lot of work, but I'll try to give you guys continual behind-the-scenes updates up until then. So the purpose of this documentary, I will say, is that I do believe in America and the larger Western civilization, we are living in a state of denial. And it's really targeted at three key categories, three completely false truths that have been pushed upon us that we're all trying to pretend aren't true, that are causing us massive, massive social pain and economic pain and spiritual pain. And frankly, it's going to ruin our country and it will collapse all of Western civilization. Those three major lies that I believe we're being forced to live by right now are the denialism around race and the fact that different races do have different behaviors, different cultures, different traditions, different priorities, different ways of life. We're told that all races are equal in every measure, and that if you have any kind of preference amongst races, whether that's spending time one-on-one with them or their contributions to society, simply measuring who's contributed what, if you come to any kind of preferential conclusion that says, I myself as a white person kind of like European societies, and when comparing them to African or Mexican or Asian or Jewish societies or Indian societies, I think it's head and shoulders above everybody else. And so I wouldn't want to live somewhere that's not majority white, aka European. And in the same sense, I think the same thing about Christianity. I think that when the large majority of the public are of the Christian faith, then that is the best thing for the individuals and it's the best thing for society. I think that's why America and many other European countries prospered, is this synergy between the European culture and Christian moral values. So we lie to people telling them that races and the past of each race doesn't matter. And then we also lie to people in saying that the differences between the various religions are inconsequential and you don't need to worry about them. You can have next door neighbors who are this religion, and then on the other side of you, they can be another religion, and extrapolate that analogy across an entire community and states and you know, the entire nation, that there's no inherent contradictions or inherent inevitable problems of having so many different religious practices, including people who are a-religious and derive their moral values from no deistic sense whatsoever.
So this different mishmash of moralities when it comes to religion or being a-religious and expecting us all to live together in peaceful harmony, I believe is a unproductive and flat-out harmful and deceptive lie. You can't have a country that is not homogeneous, meaning primarily the same ethnicity, and is also not primarily the same religion. And then this third major lie that I believe we're trying to push is the concept of feminism and the concept of gender equality, that two moms can raise a child the same way as a mom and a dad, or that two dads can raise a child the same way as a mom and a dad, or that in some way a man is the same as a woman, or that a man can get pregnant. And they've taken it to the complete absurdities of things like men breastfeeding and men being pregnant and whatnot, believing that those things are actually things that can happen in the real world. There are people who will fight tooth and nail to their deaths that those are factual statements, that men can get pregnant and that they can breastfeed and so on. But, I mean, these people, they believe that furthest extreme, you better believe they also subscribe to a belief that says a woman, because she is interchangeable with the man, has all the same inherent rights as a man because they're interchangeable. Civil rights being things like going and getting a job, going to school and getting educated, voting, that kind of stuff. You know, in the Western world, we take a lot of that stuff for granted, and we kind of forget of just how modern those concepts are. And many people to even propose the idea that maybe women shouldn't vote, or maybe women shouldn't prioritize higher education and careers, to them, that sounds like flat-out misogyny. That sounds like spinning the wheel of time back hundreds of years. And they see it as an oppressive move against women and all this kind of stuff. But in my opinion, for reasons we'll discuss, I'm sure, in more detail throughout the interview, these lies that race doesn't matter, religion doesn't matter, gender doesn't matter, there's no such thing as gender roles, one gender is not better than the other at this thing, they're all equal at everything. It is this concept of egalitarianism, where everything everybody does has to be seen as equal, one can't be more harmful than the other. It's kind of a related cousin to relativism and moral relativity, where everybody gets to decide what the true definitions of right and wrong are, according to themselves and according to their life and according to who their parents were and who their college professors were. And they take all these different things from society, put them in a blender, and then come up with their own unique definitions of what's good and bad, right and wrong. Well, that's the general prescription for society in America now. That's what we have fallen back to, is this moral relativism, which is the replacement for the universalism, which is to say that there are universal truths and a universal morality, and most universalists will say that that is handed down by a divine power, which is what somebody who has religious beliefs would say. They would say that there is a universal right and wrong. Christians would describe this as sin. They're plainly laid out in the Bible. And so if we simply obey what's in the Bible, then we are automatically obeying our divinely designed behavior. So that's a lot to say, that these three things that society is basically walking around with blinders on their eyes, trying to say, oh yeah, our religious differences aren't real, our racial differences aren't real, our gender differences aren't real. And we're even saying things that deny simple biology and your eyeballs and your heart and your organs, such as you can be healthy at any weight. It's this constant denialism of the most basic truths that I think has America in its final throes, basically, where we're at the late stage of the decline of the empire. This is the thing that really motivated me to do this documentary, was, you know, I'm sitting in church. It's an average Sunday. I've been going to the church for a few months. I like it. I like what the pastor's had to say so far. I like the congregation. It's a Baptist church. But then towards the end of the sermon, the pastor says something along the lines of, racism is not a skin thing, it's a sin thing. And for all of the reasons that I'm including in this documentary, I was immediately heartbroken. seeing a pastor preach to 300 some odd white people in the church that they are bad people who are sinning, that they are in disalignment with God, when they simply look around at the world and determine that these other racial groups are creating cultures that are not the same as their own racial group, and for having a preference of their own group versus the others, they are bad people who are living in error to God. That's not true. That's not what the Bible says. Nowhere, the word racism didn't even exist before, during the Bolshevik Revolution, I think, sometime in the 20th century. But this idea that white people are just evil because they prefer to live amongst their own fellow white people is complete trash. And it's only being preached to white people. Nobody is getting on to black people for preferring to live and marry fellow blacks. This concept of skin color being completely irrelevant and it's not a visual association with an entire race's culture, that's just false. To see somebody's skin color is to know what race they belong to. To know what race they belong to knows the history of that race's culture, their priorities, what their contributions to humankind have been in the past. And people do the same to white people all the time. People look at people of white skin and say, oh, you're a white colonialist, slave abuser, whatever, whatever. And even though those things haven't been true for hundreds of years, those are still the reputations that are assigned to white people. Not despite having never owned a slave, not even being remotely close to a slave owner, and despite never having gone on any kind of conquest to conquer another nation or to spread the gospel or anything like that, still, white people have the reputation of they owned slaves at one point in time, which is stupid because every race owned slaves at one point in time and has been the enslaved at one point in time. But more of these double standards and hypocrisy that only apply to white people. People associate and stereotype things about whites all the time based on their skin color. And so to do the same for someone of black or brown skin should be just as allowable and tolerable in society as everybody else. But it's called racism when a white person does it. Okay, what made you decide that you, of all people, needed to do something about this? The future of America, how it has to be reorganized, and what it should be reorganized around, which on my platform, I would say it has to be the two shoulders that we stood up on to begin with, which were European cultural practices and the Christian faith. That's what got us here. That's what we need to maintain. That's what we're fighting for. So of all people, I think that myself having spent 20 years agnostic, myself having spent 30 years in the South, where it's still a culture that largely revolves around religion, versus living somewhere like Portland, where it is the complete opposite. I lived there for 7 years and got to see what a godless society looks like. And so it's that kind of combination of light and dark, good and bad, that I've been fortunate enough to not necessarily plan for myself, but to just have been gifted through circumstance and God's will for me. I've gotten to see what life looks like on both sides. I'm not one of these people who was born a Christian and went to church throughout my entire life, and I just kind of inherited it, and I never was told anything otherwise, so I just went with it. Very much not the case. As I said, I spent 20 years agnostic and really enjoyed challenging people of faith to hear more about why they believe what they believe, but I can tell you it was never because of something they said that ultimately I became a Christian. It required me to go and live in Portland, where religion has been snuffed out of society, and not just snuffed out, but actually demonized and blamed for all of the bad things about life. It took me going and living there to actually find myself interacting with Jesus Christ again at the later age of 33 years old. And in the 4 years since then, I've been born again, and the Holy Spirit has moved me to try to speak to both sides because I've been on both sides, is, I guess, the simplest answer to that question. So how would you introduce yourself? On your social media, you describe yourself as the president of the Christian Patriarchal Liftocracy. It's a little bit of a tongue-in-cheek, self-appointed title that it's pointed towards a very narrow group of people, which is to say Christians, male Christians, who lived. That's a very small group of the population, right? We're talking single-digit percentages. But I feel like in this age of denialism, we need people who are courageous enough to take the arrows, whether that's the social ostracization or the economic penalties of being withheld jobs and opportunities because the opinions you express are unpopular. Whatever it may be, we're living in this age of denialism where anybody who speaks the truth is severely punished for doing so. And so the only way we get out of this situation, because the truth is never going away, men are not women, women are not men. The races are real, they are biological, they're not societal constructs. And with every race, there is a very long history of documented behavior and documented social preferences, traditions, values, that just because you move somebody from one ancestry to a different place, it doesn't turn off all of that biology. So to deny all of that in combination with the religious differences and everything, the people that are going to pull us out of this web of denial are very courageous people. Men are always the leaders of revolutions. There is no revolution that takes place because a bunch of women got together and said, we have to change things. So by default, we already know this future revolution that needs to take place in America, kind of like an American Renaissance is what I'm hoping for, is going to be led by white Christian men who are goal-oriented and who are understanding of how faith works. That it's a religious belief. Literally, it's a, you know, it's tied to your Christian faith, but you also hold a religious conviction to faith in all things, not just when I do right by God, then I and everybody around me will enjoy the benefit of that. But also in the small matters of taking care of oneself and becoming educated and becoming physically healthy, becoming spiritually active in your relationship with God, being able to structure your entire life so that you can actually tackle all of these simultaneous priorities, consistently putting forth effort towards all of them for years. That's the kind of very small group, admittedly, very small group, that is going to be at the nucleus of the revolution. These are the people who are willing to work the hardest, who are willing to spend the late night hours away from the rest of society, who are enjoying the rest of society's benefits, all of the hookup culture, all of the drugs and the booze that's available, all of the rock concerts and all of the distractions, the bread and circus. That's where the general population is going to be, and they're going to be there all the way through the collapse of the empire. They're going to remain that distracted because that's what the bread and circus are for. And so I do believe with sincere faith that it's going to take the people who have a razor-sharp focus to focus on the things they know are important to grow as an individual that they can then turn around and help the society with. That's who it's going to be that changes the nation. And that's not going to come from atheist women. Okay, that's not what's going to lead the revolution. That's how I feel about the Christian patriarchal liftocracy. Having looked at some of your posts, I can see why people call you a white supremacist. You seem to post on a nearly daily basis racial politics and don't hold back on stating your opinions about race. That being said, are you a white supremacist? Fair enough question, and I'm grateful to be asked because I want to set the record on this subject because it's a deep, deep subject and we need to be clear about who we are, what we want for the world. So from that position, I would describe myself as a white advocate. I am somebody who sees white self-esteem, this is the self-esteem of the white race, as something that needs uplifting. In this exact same way that there are thousands of black advocates and black members of the black community who feel they need to uplift the black community and stand up for their heritage and their traditions and their priorities, etc. The exact same thing exists for the Asian community. The exact same thing exists for the Hispanic community. Lord knows the Jews are the most self-important group of all people. They have hundreds of organizations specifically for the protection and the growth of Jewish communities. I mean, they're like the pioneers of racial solidarity. And so for white people, for a white person to raise his hand and say, that thing that all of you other races are doing, you know, trying to protect yourself, trying to not go extinct, trying to not be victimized and taken advantage of by anybody else. I think white people should do that too. Like that seems kind of like a normal thing to do. We should stand up for ourselves. And so if I'm living in a country that used to be majority white, in 1960, America was nearly 90% white. We're talking one lifetime ago, and hanging out now in 2023, I see my country only 62% white and falling fast. And I see the real world repercussions of that all around me. Then these things matter to me. They're just kind of like a natural observation that, you know what? I think Europeans had a way of doing things and creating societies that I really prefer over the way other ethnicities create cultures and the societies that they produce. They don't feel the same to me. I don't want to live there. That's why I've never moved there. And frankly, that's why nobody immigrates to their countries. All of them immigrate to European countries. And so it's not a matter of saying one is superior, that white supremacy is the label that likes to be put onto this subject. But as I said, all I'm doing is being an advocate of white people and saying we have our own interest as a group the exact same way other races have interest as a group. None of this is morally questionable, and I don't understand why anybody would get offended about any of it. But that should tell you something in and of itself, that someone simply speaking up for white people, saying, I actually like white people. I prefer to actually be around mainly white people. Whenever a black person is around me, I dislike them because they're black. That's not what I'm saying. And this is an important subtopic, and that is the difference between individuals and groups. Especially in the boomer era, 1960s forward, after the civil rights movement, this idea of diversity is our strength came about. It's the marketing name for the lie that I mentioned earlier about race not mattering. It's kind of funny because people want to pretend that race is a societal construct and it's not real, but then at the same time, they want to say that diversity is our strength. Well, the only way for diversity to be a strength, by definition, has to mean that people other than yourselves have some kind of unique characteristics that they're bringing to the table. Otherwise, they wouldn't be of strength to you. They would be of no extra benefit. So if you're going to say that diversity is our strength, then that's you confessing that the other races are different than you. Now, simultaneously, you're saying that those differences that they have are clearly a net benefit to us, and whatever other differences they have that might be not so advantageous for us, well, those don't outweigh the benefits, and so therefore, diversity is a net strength. Well, in my thinking, I don't believe that whatsoever. I don't believe that diversity is our strength. I don't believe that anybody can reasonably make that case. I don't know what Africans or Hispanics or Jews or Asians have meaningfully done for this country. And I'm talking big, big picture. When I ask people for examples on how has diversity enriched our lives so much, knowing that America was a 90% white country all the way through the 60s. So everything that we have right now, modern technology, other than the digital age, which was also a creation of white people anyway, but all the way up before the digital age, everything that was built by white people. The Industrial Revolution, the automobile industry, sanitation, biology, all this other stuff. All of these schools of education, these were all creations of white Europeans. And so you still have to prove to me what it was that Africans brought to the table that greatly improved America. If you want to say slave labor, that doesn't fit the bill. Slave labor was a net disadvantage for America for reasons we can go into. Largely, the racial grievance factor that we have had to live with for the last 400 years has clearly outweighed any benefit that America ever may have had for utilizing slavery. Now, that being said, in the whole North versus South Civil War, the economic consideration was given to, is slavery a net advantage for slave owners? And it wasn't so conclusive that it was. In fact, many people held the belief that once you actually freed the slaves, the free market allowed for a better, more flexible economy. And, you know, we won't get into all of that. But anyway, this question of, am I a white supremacist? I don't know where exactly that definition comes from or what it's supposed to mean. It's, how do you respond to this question? Do you think white culture is better, more enjoyable than other racial cultures? Yes, absolutely. I think we would all agree with that. I think you don't even have a position to argue back against, because there's not a single non-European country you would like to go and live in preference of America or some other European country. You can't tell me that you'd prefer to live in India, or you'd prefer to live in communist China, or you'd prefer to live in the drug and human trafficking and arms trafficking cartel that we call the continent of Africa. You don't want to live in Central America or South America. So you tell me one example of a non-white society that you would prefer to live in. Is that supremacy to say that white European people have somehow created the most enjoyable, prosperous, safe, freedom-adhering societies? Call it whatever you will. But the fact of the matter is, we all agree, because the numbers don't lie. People vote with their feet. If they thought that this was an oppressive country where opportunity isn't afforded to people who aren't white, we wouldn't have 2 million immigrants in the Biden administration. We wouldn't have 1 million immigrants a year before that. So it's just kind of ludicrous, this idea that there's something morally wrong with anybody who would say, I prefer to live in a white neighborhood or in a primarily white state or a primarily white country. That's not morally wrong. That's using common sense to say, I don't want to live amongst shit in the street and trash piled up 12 feet high in India. And I don't want to live underneath the dictatorship of communist China or one of the Korean states. And as I said, I don't want to be human trafficked over in Africa. It's like, use deductive reasoning and find out, I'm not going to say it's supreme, but I think it's probably preferable. So that's where I am on the question of, am I a white supremacist? Before we get into what you allege is happening to whites, many people would argue that what you call the white race is actually a collection of disparate people from a large number of countries. That's this whole deconstructionist debate over, is there even such a thing as the white race? You'll notice that this only happens to white Europeans. That nobody is asked to defend the concept of the African race, because there's a bunch of countries within Africa, and so you need to specify which exact countries you can be called African. Like, it doesn't work that way. We all know what we mean when we say whites. We mean people of fair complexion, who have the spectrum of hair colors, who have a spectrum of eye colors, and have a certain facial feature, nose features, eye width, lip shape, hair texture. And you can even get down onto the chromosomal levels and the 23andMe and all that kind of stuff. And there was an interesting study that came out. I can't remember who pushed out. I want to say it was actually done by 23andMe, but I could be wrong on that. But it said something along the lines of, high 90% people, that's like something like 98% of people who are visually white, who you would call white just by looking at them, share the same European ancestors. So, as I said, this tactic of trying to deconstruct if there's even a real thing such as the European white race, it's very insulting and it's very sinister, because nobody pushes this same deconstructionist attempt towards any other race. America was founded by immigrants from England and France and the Dutch. And over time, additional European countries came over here, Germans, Italians, etc. But the common thread throughout all of those countries is that they are all European. And so no one ever argues, you'll hear this people say that, well, America was always a country of immigrants to begin with. Okay, let's use some deduction again and say, okay, well, I just want to understand what you're saying. If America was a country of immigrants, so you mean like African immigrants, right? No, well, no, not them. Oh, so America was like a country with like a bunch of Asian immigrants. No, not them. Well, America must have been a country of a bunch of Hispanic immigrants. No, not them. Oh, so I guess it was Jews who settled in America. No, not them. It's like, okay, do you see where this is going? It is all European countries who came here and created the initial settlements. And then over time, other ethnicities were allowed to come here and settle as well. What would you say to those who are willing to acknowledge that race is a real biological supported fact, but that other than phenotypes and the way we all look, race is only skin deep? They would say skin color is not a predictor of behavior. As Martin Luther King said, judge a man by the content of his character and not by his skin. Okay, I'm glad this came back up because I mentioned earlier Martin Luther King and the very, very important nuanced difference between when you're talking about the character of an individual versus the character of groups of individuals. So these are very different subjects, by the way. I mean, this is like saying there's no difference between chemistry and anatomy. It's like, well, yes, they're both science, but they're actually very different topics. I mean, the study of individual behavior is psychology. The study of group behavior is sociology. And those are different courses that you can devote your entire academic career or professional life to. And so to say that, well, listen, we need to judge everybody based on their character. Well, that's a kind of no duh, I agree also, which just means hold everybody equally accountable to the law and ignore their skin color, which is not what we're doing right now. What we're doing right now is saying if you get arrested and you're black, well, it's probably not because you have bad behavior. It's probably because society failed you. The establishment failed you. You weren't given enough free money when you were growing up. You went to the wrong school growing up. Whatever it is, it's not your fault. It's society's fault, and that's because you're black. Now, if a white person goes and commits the same crimes or is as underachieving as that black person, they're just straight up self-accountable. Sorry, it's actually even more than that. It's the opposite. It's that, well, you're actually white. So whether or not you grew up in poverty, whether or not your family had zero generational wealth, you could have been born into debt, it doesn't matter. You're white, therefore, according to mainstream universities and according to CNN and all the other intellectuals, because you're white in America or in any other European country, you have no excuses. You are expected to succeed. And when you don't succeed, it's because you're lazy. It's because you're privileged and so on. And so that's the discussion of individuals. When you're talking about judging a group behavior, this is something that shouldn't be controversial because even our own government does this. Every politician, when they go and campaign, whether it's a presidential election or midterms or whatever, I promise you, all of those Washington, D.C. think tanks that they hire to figure out how to structure their political campaign, meaning which demographic of voters to target, pandering to blacks, pandering to minorities, pandering to women, pandering to LGBT. All of that pandering and all of those political positions that they take to run their campaign, those are informed by what? Group studies. Surveys where they go and put out thousands of applications to people where they fill in their race and their gender and their sexual orientation. And then politicians and these analytical firms come together and look at group behavior. And this is unquestionably true. We know that 90% of blacks vote Democrat. And we know that Democrats know that. And so we know that Democrats intentionally try to maintain that by perpetually talking to blacks and telling them that white people are your oppressors and that you'll never be able to succeed unless the government helps you out. That's just the Democrat tactic. And that comes from the study of blacks as a group. So your own government is doing it. The politicians you vote for are looking at group behavior. So it's not a racist concept to look at group behavior. And this is very, very important for everybody to think about, because when I, on my social media channel or when other people do the same, they'll share a crime statistic from the FBI that says violent crime in America, 50% of it comes from black males, which only account for 6% of the entire population. So 6% of the entire United States population commits 50% of the violent crime. So that's a serious problem, and people should get to the bottom of that problem, right? We could take care of half of the violent crime in this country, literally half of it, if we simply set our focused attention on black males. However, when you bring up this idea, the liberals will try to fight back and say that, well, that's because the police are targeting them somehow and only charging black people, and they're letting white people who do the same crimes go. It's difficult to get into this conversation because at that point it's unfalsifiable. There is no reports that you can pull. There's no empirical data that they can even provide that says this is the number of times where a white person was committing a violent crime such as homicide, rape, etc. But the police looked at him and said, oh, he's white, let's not charge him. Because he's not being charged, because he's not being even apprehended, there's no way to measure it, therefore there's no way to disprove it. So the left side will use an unfalsifiable argument that says, well, the reason blacks just look this way is because whites always get away with it. And it's the easiest position to take because there's no way to fight against it. There's no way to pull the reports and to prove with math, as if statistics even mattered to these people, that what they're saying is a lie. And they know that, and that's how they can get away with it election after election after election. But this idea of group behavior being measurable and being critical in terms of getting the most bang for your buck as a politician when you're trying to change society, if you find out that half of your violent crime is coming from a very small group of people, then you would want to change the behavior of that very small group of people. The reason to focus on groups and not the individuals, as Martin Luther King suggested, he said, oh, no, no, we should not look at the groups. Don't try to judge Africans by Africans' behavior. Don't do that. That's evil. That's racist. You need to treat every black person with a complete blank state, no stereotyping, and judge them by their behavior. Individual behavior is not demonstrative of group behavior. And what I can say about that to make that very, very obvious is when you see somebody engaged in the looting of a store, that's not individual behavior, that's group behavior. Meaning you cannot have a looting of a store with only one person. There's no such thing as a one person looting of Target. You know, looting Target only happens when you're experiencing mob behavior. It only happens when you're experiencing group behavior. And so when you look at all the video footage of all these lootings that are occurring throughout the United States and the crime wave, and it's continually one demographic of people, you look at the group studies that also confirm what your eyeballs are seeing, and you say, it seems like the black community are without a doubt disproportionately violent and breaking laws. Something has to be done about that. And if you say something has to be done about that, you're labeled racist and a bigot and all these other things. And it's not helpful. It's just not. It's not going to ever fix the problem until people become numb to being called racist. Because the fact of the matter is, if we can influence that small portion of society and get such a 5x, 6x bang for our buck, then we would be stupid not to. The influence that a group can make on a society is far more than the individual as well. And I'm just explaining through several different bullet points how it's not an option, how you have to study group behavior. Because understanding how groups work, groups have a much larger impact on anything, whether you're talking about the results of a vote or if you're talking about looting and mob behavior. The axe or the sledgehammer that a group wields is much more powerful than the sledgehammer that an individual wields. And so you best believe, if you want a safe society, then you need to have a very, very keen understanding that is open, transparent, and honest about all of the various groups and measuring their behavior.